Thanks. So I'm Phil Cantor. I'm also a trustee or a board member or whatever you call it here. And besides that, I'm on the school committee and my child goes to Frontier. And every once in a while, you get to run across some of the really, really incredible people that are serving in making the institutions around us run. And the school is something like that, like, you know, like an iceberg. All you ever really see is the tip of it, you know, like round budget time. And so here, you know, that great 99% of it that's submerged that you never get to see. So this is sort of a glimpse into that. This is what the kids from this community get to experience every day, which is just an amazing, as you will see, is an amazing thing. So I also got to serve on several committees with him, and I really became fond of him, and I think he's terrific. He wrote this incredible book, which is a great story about how it came out. I won't tell the story, but I love the story. So I'm just really proud that he's here, and I hope you give a nice warm welcome to Jeremy Rogers.
Boy, I thought there'd be like 15 people here, because it was me. Thank you for coming out. I know it was 44 degrees out, maybe that helped. Joe, it wasn't the other night. Phil asked me to come and talk to you about some of the stuff that I put in my book and sort of how it got there. And I noticed in the recorder yesterday, I'm going to talk about 18,000 years of Conway. I can't fit all that in tonight. But if you could come back, you know, for the next 7 or 8 years, Tuesday nights, we can probably do a whole lot with that. But let's see. Nice. As Phil said, I wrote a book and got it published last September. And when I started it, it seemed like I could write. I'd done, you know, master's thesis and stuff like that. And I taught writing and other things. And it was going to be a 4 or 5 month project, maybe, in my spare time. And it turned out about 3.5 years. And I still like to put a lot more things in there, right? One of the fascinating things about it was learning things that I didn't know. I've been teaching a class about local history since 2001 at Frontier, and learned all kinds of stuff. But along the way, you get, like Phil said, tips of icebergs of history. And I was looking in depth at things and trying to decide what to put in there. Came across a $2 bill from Conway, which I thought was kind of interesting. I don't know if you have any of those, but many years ago in a whole different life, spent some time working for the Recorder and in the West County News when that was around. And one of the things that I remember the editor telling me when I was talking to him one day was, why don't we cover some bigger stories? And he said, well, you can cover big stories if they have a local aspect. And the idea that I sort of developed was that all history is local. Every event that's happened in America is affected here, in Deerfield, in California, and everywhere else in the country, right? And so I tried to take that approach with the book. And the driving force behind it was the class that I've been teaching, which is a community school collaborative partnership between us and PVMA, Compton Valley Memorial Association, you know, Deerfield, Historic Deerfield. We also have used resources from the Anthropology Lab at UMass and the Beinecke Museum at Amherst College, stuff like that. We work in partnership with them to bring Frontier students out into the valley to get their hands on history. Instead of sitting in my room listening to me for 86 minutes a day for 90 days in a row, we spend 20 to 25 days out in the community, for that block of time. We have a nice van, so the class is limited to 14. And it allows us to really appeal to a much wider audience of students. There's something in it for all of the students at Frontier, especially the ones who like hands-on learning, right? But that said, it's still an honors class, so we expect more of them than regular classes. And started out, as I said, 1998, a couple of years before I started teaching it, and what it was a major grant from NEH, National Endowment for Humanities. I think it was $1.5 million to develop a website at PVMA to put their artifacts online in a way that the world could enjoy them, and develop a curriculum with the resources at Frontier. And we got to buy all kinds of books, literally hundreds of books that related to local history. I have file cabinets, there's 7 of them in my room. They're full of articles and journal articles, National Geographic, all kinds of things that relate to the Deerfield area.
Wow.
It's huge. And all the stuff is different, and the drawers are packed. In my room, I got 372 books about Deerfield, Conway, Whately, Sunderland, Ashfield, just this general little vicinity. It's Deerfield is said to be the most written about town in America. Not counting big cities, because I'm sure they got lots. And we have a whole lot of journals. And then out of these gray file boxes full of newspaper clippings, I've got several hundred on tobacco growing in Sunderland, if anybody's interested in researching it. It's nice. And that's so much stuff, right? And my room is a mess, right? And I put 30 students in there and myself for some classes, and they're falling over boxes of books and things like that. And I decided that I would put together what you might call an anthology, a collection of things from all those piles of papers and books and everything else that would be useful in class. I wouldn't have to go down to the photocopy machine 20 times a week and get a couple more pages for the class. And it would save money on photocopying, it would save shoe leather, and I thought it'd be easy. And I talked to the curriculum director, and she said, oh, what a great idea. Frontier will pay. We'll take it to Staples, we'll get it photocopied, you know, get one of those little things put through it so it looked like a book. And I'm like, fabulous, great. And I was so excited. 152,000 words later, and 3.5 years, 410 pages, 457 illustrations, maps, and charts, and whatever else I wrote up there. I was a little unnerved about it. My wife Susan is here, and she probably attests to the franticness that life took on. And I was reading the New York Times one day, and there was an article in there about a machine that a bookstore in Paris had bought. And they had downsized the bookstore from Paris's largest bookstore to something like 700 square feet. But they were still offering 10 million different books within 3 minutes.
Wow.
And it's all thanks to this database of PDF files of books which can be printed on this machine in 3 minutes or less. My book actually takes 20 minutes because it's got 102 color pages, so it takes a little longer. But I called the guy, and come to find out, there are very few of these machines in the world. There are just a few hundred. And there are 3 in New York, 2 in Boston, and 1 in St. Johnsbury, Vermont. Yeah. Have you been to St. John's? I figure that's why people are chuckling. I went up to St. Johnsbury. I met with the man, talked to him, and eventually got the book printed. And as they say, the rest is history, right? Didn't want to create a textbook. I started out doing that, and then I thought, well, if I create a textbook, I'm going to have 14 students who use it. And I'm putting in how many hours? We'll do something a little different. So what I ended up doing was making a much more general audience book, and hopefully more interesting to people. And well, I just put a little bit in here. I have 8 curriculum units that I teach, which are about 2 weeks long, but end up at 30 chapters, one for each of those 8. I'm not very good at math, so I teach history. What I wanted to do was look at the history of Deerfield, which is what my class does, from basically the beginning of time up until the 20th century. We look at geology. We go to Amherst College and look at Edward Hitchcock's collection of dinosaur tracks, which are second to none, right? It's probably the world's best. Hitchcock used to be minister in Conway for, I think, 2 years before that. Mm-hmm. He was at Deerfield Academy, and then he ended up at Amherst College. And I thought it was a mark of pride for Conway. They voted at town meeting to pay a bunch of money to Amherst College. It was $1,400 back in those days. And then they gave the same to Mount Holyoke when they were starting Mount Holyoke. But anyway, I digress. So we look at the geology, we look at how the landscape forms and the forces that do that so that we can understand when people come into the landscape, how it changes and how the landscape changes the people, right? So we start out with the geology, glaciation, glacier goes away, Lake Hitchcock comes, people show up around 12,500 years ago. There was a conference this past summer, which I think the date of the earliest evidence is 12,400. Yeah. So it's a pretty long time ago when people haven't been in the Americas for maybe more than 15,000-20,000 years, and they were here, right? Wandering around chasing woolly mammoths or things like that. Just an idea of some of the resources that you can look at BVMA without even going to the museum. They have websites on all kinds of stuff. The class I teach at Frontier has beta tested all of these for BVMA over the years. I found this picture, which I put on the cover of the book, which I thought was great because it's around 1870, and you can see right here is the railroad station in Old Deerfield, along with the freight shed, and there's actually a freight car parked there. It looks like an aerial shot, but the guy just climbed up the mountain and back. So the question I was thinking about after Bill contacted me about doing this was, why the heck did I put Conway in the book? And I came up with 3 reasons, and then I came up with a whole bunch more. As you heard earlier, it's one of the frontier towns, and I want to appeal to all the students at Frontier, right? Conway started out life in the way, way, way back days as part of Deerfield. And the history of Conway adds a lot of dimensions that Deerfield doesn't. Sunderland doesn't, Whately doesn't. This is the most industrial town in the 19th century, right? Cutleries and things like that start. The water power in town drives the history of town for a while. Right? And I decided I'd go back and think about the actual origin of Conway because Conway is forever tied to the town of Dedham, Mass. Right? When Mass Bay colony is established, it expands, and this huge land grant, almost 130,000 acres, is given to about 70 families in Dedham. And they establish a little village, and there's plenty of spare land. And as it says here, the thought is, this land will last you guys for a long time. You know, your kids will grow up, need a farm, plenty of land. Their kids will grow up, plenty of land. Lots of farms, you know, generation after generation. And while to an extent that's true, not necessarily, right? So life gets in the way of the best plans. You can see right here a little red arrow, Dedham. This is the Mass Bay colony. Dotted line down here denotes Plymouth. Right? That's Dedham as it is now. And sort of a little better map of all the different towns that eventually start within those confines of that land grant to Dedham. Right? So you got everything from Wrentham all the way up to Wellesley. Right? The blue crosses I put on there are what are known as praying towns that were established way, way back. And that's what I want to look at just a little bit. You can notice that some of the land here, certainly part of the land here, is taken up with praying towns. The oldest timber framed, I love architecture, right? The oldest timber framed house in America is in Dedham, right? Around about 1637, still standing. But I heard it sank into the ground 2 winters ago when they had so much snow. Mm-hmm. And the foundation isn't that good. But in 1646, General Court in Massachusetts in Boston passed an act for the propagation of the gospel amongst the Indians. And Reverend John Elliott and some other missionaries decided that they would teach Christianity to the Indians. Right? And in England, the Long Parliament in 1649 passed an ordinance that basically raised money for Elliot and other missionaries to do the work. They raised £12,000, which was a heck of a lot of money back in those days. And I have no idea how much it would be today, but it's several million dollars. Right, and Elliot started doing this missionary work amongst the Indians, and eventually one of the ways in which they figured they could get more Indians interested in becoming Christian was, we're not going to like take and buy their land from them, maybe we can give them some land and let them settle on some land, which was theirs, and anyway, so theirs in the first place, right? So, why did they want to convert Indians? Well, yeah, there's always the thing of, well, we want to convert them to Christianity. That would be the Christian thing to do and save the poor heathens, right? The savages back in the day. But think about what was going on in the 1640s, 1650s. There were not peaceful relationships everywhere with the people who were originally here before the English, right? And one of the thoughts that they had was that if they created these praying towns full of Christianized Indians who were basically on the Puritan side, it would be a buffer between Indians who may not like the Puritans and the Puritans, right? They're also going to be allies. And there's always strength in numbers, right? So they're going to be on the Puritan side, hopefully. And they can act as guides, translators. They can help with facilitating business and things like that, trading, right? So there was a whole lot of things which appealed to the Puritans about doing this, right? And you can't see it real well, but this is in the language of the Indian at the time, right? It's a Bible that was created at the time that they could have so they could read the Bible. I don't know how many of them read a language that hadn't been written down before. But it seemed like a good idea. And this is the cover of it. And if you're an Indian, why the heck would you want to convert from your own religion to Christianity? That's the question that I would ask. It's okay to figure out the Puritans are doing it for those reasons, but the Indians get land in what would probably be considered an English town, right? So they get more safety. Their survival is a little more assured. And eventually they become Red Puritans. Mm-hmm. And they're referred to in a number of places as Red Puritans. And Natick is carved out of Dedham and given to the Indians. Right. In all, there are about 20 of these praying towns that are taken from land that the English had already been granted, and they're established as praying Indian towns. And for Dedham, that meant they lost land. I'm sort of cutting a long story a little shorter. Mm-hmm. This erosion of that original 130,000 acre grant that they had spurred the residents of Dedham to ask the general court, hey, can we get some more land? Some nice land somewhere? And general court said, yeah, you can get 8,000 acres. You can't have more than two parcels. It's gotta be one or two parcels. You can't have more. You can't have like little bits all over the place. It's gotta be a piece. And they started scouting. They were out around Worcester and places, and eventually they ended up hearing about some land 12 or 14 miles north of Hadley, was the quote. And they decided to hire a local guy, a guy named John Pinchon, who you may have heard of. Pinchon's father, William, was the founder of Springfield in 1636. And then William Pinchon fell out of favor because he wrote a book which was critical of Puritanism, and Puritans sort of ran him out of town and went back to Springfield, gave everything to his kid and went back to England, because otherwise he'd have to renounce his views. But the Pinchons end up controlling a heck of a lot of stuff out of here, right? He's probably the wealthiest man in Western Mass at one point by a long shot. I think statistically, if you put everybody else's stuff together, it didn't amount to the amount that Pinchon had. It was about 90% of what Pinchon had. In terms of land, he owned a huge amount. He was commander of the militia, he was a magistrate, and mill owner, and on pretty good terms with a whole lot of the Indians, right? And I have to give credit to Peter, because this is, I think, from your dissertation, the last part with the beaver pelts. Pinchon lived in a world where it was credit. There was very little cash. Everything was done, bartered, exchanged, and so on. And Pinchon, when you went to the store, would give you what you needed and put you in the book. You had your own little page, maybe. And then when you had something, you'd come back and give it to him, and he'd put you on the other side of the ledger. And it would cancel each other out eventually. Or you'd die, and your estate would settle, right? And he's the guy who you go to when you have beaver pelts, other things like that, stuff that you want to sell, right? So the local native people around here would go to Pinchon with stuff, and they get things like cloth and hardware and tools and things like that, maybe some guns. And heat exchanger for beaver pelts. Beaver pelts were a big deal because everybody wanted a fashionable hat. Remember Abe Lincoln with a nice felt hat? And so beaver pelts were worth quite a lot of money. And people went and hunted them virtually to extinction. Now what do? Here you are, you're living out in your longhouse out in Deerfield or somewhere, or Agawam, and you come into Springfield to get some stuff, and it's like, wow, I've got this, but I want all that. I said, no problem, help yourself. And this goes on for a while, and then think about it. How do you pay the debts? Land becomes a commodity, right? And Pynchon is hired or appointed, I'm not sure which word to use, I don't know if anybody really knows. I haven't found it in the records whether they paid him or...
They did.
They paid him? And he ends up making five separate deals with people for land, which becomes a piece of land which eventually is known as Deerfield. Four of the five deeds are still around. The ones that were signed by Pynchon and the Indians and some other different people. And one thing that I really want to say is that a lot of people, they sort of took the land from the Indians and gave them a couple of beads for it, and then they really screwed over the Indians. They really didn't. In our terms, maybe, and we're looking at this with a 21st century eye, but if you go back to the time this is happening, and we can't know what it was like because we're not them, which is the whole big problem you have in history. You're not them, and you're not living in the place where they lived, under the conditions they lived, right? But in all these deeds that I've read, both sides get value from the contract. So it's a valid contract. Both sides seem to be relatively happy at the time that the contracts are made and the deeds are created. Whether, and this is the sort of iffy part, whether the people who gave the land to the English had the authority to do that, that's the question. I've got three of them, which I put up in here. There's the chalk deed, which is probably the most seen one of these things. And there's a translation of it. And in the first line, it says, for good and valuable considerations here, there, unto moving, right? The person who's giving up the land is getting good and valuable considerations. It doesn't list what they are. We don't know, right? But the person who's giving up the land, chalk, alias check, doth reserve the liberty of fishing for Indians and the rivers and waters and free liberty to hunt deer, other wild creatures, gather chestnuts and walnuts and other things on the commons. If it's commons, I think it goes without saying back in those days, anybody could gather on the commons. That was the nature of it. That was okay until the fences went up and the cows and other things started grazing. This is another deed, and Ahimunkwit, which I'm probably mangling, down at the bottom, received part of the payment, 20 fathoms of wampum. Right? Wampum really wasn't money. Wampum was a thing that sealed deals. Right? It was the same as the handshake that you make at the car dealer. Right? It's like, you gotta buy the car? Sure. Okay. Great. Come back with the money. Give me a check. But got some, and then this one, which is Mashalisk, the old woman, mother of, I have no idea how to pronounce her name. It's the earliest of the deeds, it's maybe the first one of the five. I don't know. the one that's missing, I have no idea.
So that's probably a fourth.
Well, the other two are dated later.
The 60s. This is 72. Fidgety.
Darn, you're right.
The interesting thing with this is, at the same time that this deed is negotiated, Hatfield negotiates a deed for the land, and the dividing line is Sugarloaf Brook.
Right.
And it was decided in that year by the general court 2 months earlier that Deerfield had encroached on Hatfield land. And this deed was bought specifically to validate Deerfield's claim to the land north of Sugarloaf Brook.
All right. Yeah, I misread this when I was putting this together. My apologies. But I like this deed because it actually gives you some detail about what she gets in the deal. Right? If you look down in the middle, consideration of a debt of 10 large beavers and other debts of her sons. She acknowledges herself engaged for the payment and just in due debts. Moreover, in consideration, 60 fathoms of wampum, 2 coats, some cotton, several other small things, all which the said Mashalik acknowledges to have received and to be therewith fully satisfied and contented. So, are they swindling people out of things? They may be. Did they feel that way? I'm not really sure. Just an aerial shot. I love these things. Mm-hmm. You can get them on Google and all those kind of places. This is much of the original Deerfield grant. You can see the Connecticut River on the right-hand side, sort of almost in the middle is 91, and then this really meandering piece of river. Whoops. There is the Deerfield River in back of DA, right, and up around Pine Hill. They lay out this 8,000 acre lot that Pynchon helps them get and divide it up into 43 lots. Right? The 43 lots are owned by the proprietors of Dedham. To be a proprietor, and there were 79 of them, you had to be resident at a certain time and you had to have land and so on, and status in the community. Right? None of the Dedham proprietors ever moved to Deerfield. They petitioned, they get this extra land for whatever reason they wanted it, and then, oh, they sell it and they rent it for farming and so on, and they seem to do okay, but they really don't come and settle in Deerfield. First mention of Deerfield is in 1674, right? And I think it's interesting, as a really quick aside, when you look at, and this is north of Old Deerfield, it's the land use. It's laid out in the English medieval way. Long, thin strips of land. There's one particular strip, which is right through there. And if you go up to Old Deerfield, you can see it. Yeah. Sometimes these things are planted separately. And it's about 12 feet wide.
Yeah.
And the reason was, this is about a mile wide between 5 and 10 and the river. Yeah. If you've got an oxen team and a plow, every time you're going to turn it around, you're wasting time and effort. If you can plow a long furrow for a mile, turn around, come back and be done, nice. That's way better than going 60 feet back and forth in little square rectangular fields. So all the land was laid out, and each house lot would get a portion of the best land, the meadows, the woods, and all the other different types of land within that area. So you have places to serve all your needs, hopefully. Plus, if you were the minister and you got the bigger house lot, you probably got the bigger piece of field as well, and the bigger piece of woods, and so on. Right? And as Deerfield grows in size, eventually Deerfield breaks apart. Right? And Deerfield becomes all or part of Greenfield, Sheldon, Conway, Huntstown, which is Ashfield, right? We'll just go back to the slides because I think I missed part of this.
One more.
No, never mind. Why do they have to divide up the town? Right? There's huge towns out there, the Belcher town, or Plymouth. Right? They're huge in terms of land. Well, you're expected to go to church, and there's a church in Deerfield. What if you're living up here in Conway, or up in Shelton someplace, and you've got to go down, and you don't have one? And there's not many families. How do you get families in? How do you expand? If you're gonna do 8 miles, like I put 8 miles of bad road by horse and buggy, I'm not envious of anybody who has to do that, stay in the car. You're also relatively isolated. And you're disconnected from everything that's happening, right? And it's not convenient. Where do your kids go to school, right? You're supposed to have your kids go to school and things like that. So if they're going to go down to Deerfield, that's kind of far. I put this in because I had it. And my sympathy to everybody who got affected by the tornado. I thought it was a nice picture because you're sort of looking towards what used to be the center of town from what is the center of town. And early 1700s, Reverend Williams in Deerfield petitioned for more land. It was a good thing to do, I guess, back then. And he just wanted a 9 mile extension of the border to the west. Just a little more land. I'm not quite sure how wide Deerfield was, but it's probably made at least twice as wide. And eventually they get it, it's granted, and it lay basically dormant, unused for half a century. And there are a number of reasons that may have happened, not least of which would be the threat of attack by Indians. The last one is the Bars Raid in 1746, right? 1760, Montreal was ceded to the British, and the French threat was gone, the Indian threat was gone. Things were much more stable for the communities. And Deerfield in 1750 and again in 1760 decided to create lots in that 9 mile piece of land. If they can create lots, then they can sell them, they can rent them, they can portion them out. And with all the best intentions, they really didn't do much about it. They laid out one 10 acre lot for a man named John Blackman to put up a mill. And we know nothing of it after that action. We don't know if he ever built a mill or what happened to it. But by 1762, they had 140 plots surveyed and laid out. The minimum size was 75 acres, and more than 100 of those 140 lots were over 150 acres. That becomes Conway, and nobody from Deerfield moves up here. It's people from other ways, other places. Until Cyrus Wright buys lot 138 in 1762, moves to Conway from Rutland, and his wife gives birth to the first baby, Beulah Rice, in 1764. And they're a family of firsts, unfortunately, because Mrs. Rice is the first person in town to die. So it was kind of ironic, like nobody came and like died on the way through or anything. And you probably know these things, but second person who moved to town was probably Josiah Boyden, and he buys half of lot 136, right? As far as I know, the Rice lot is sort of left when you're going towards Auntie's farm on Roaring Brook Road, and there's a disused road goes down through, and it was down in there. And then, and I think it's great and far-sighted, they approved for a schoolhouse shortly afterwards. First town meeting is in August, and in September, they've approved the schoolhouse. They don't build it for another 7 or 8 years, but they hire a dame to come and teach the children. Right? One of the first laws in the Mass Bay Colony was the old DeLuga law, which said you had to teach the kids to read so they could read the Bible and not be deluded by the devil. So you had to have that school. Right? You really don't want to be deluded by the devil. And we'll put a few pictures in on the end because I think my time has run over a little bit. But there's a few of my students, there's a couple of Conway kids in there you may or may not recognize. 2 years ago, and we were up making dinner on the open fire at the Indian house in old Deerfield. They were dressed in period costumes and we're having a wahoo time. And where did that come from? Going backwards. I can't go backwards. All right. That was interesting.
Is the book for sale?
Yeah, and I have a few of the books. If anybody's interested in a copy, I'm going to donate part of the price to Conway Historical Society. I've got a few copies in my bag back here. Talk to me afterwards. Well, if you want one later, I got some flyers. You can take one home and email me. Anybody? Questions?
I thought a town had to have a church in order to be incorporated.
I think...
What was the question?
Yeah. I thought a town had to have a church in order to be incorporated.
The church was planned and was under construction. A lot of the towns around here, when they're first carved off, and I'm thinking of Sunderland, it's a while before the church is actually up and functioning, like a church building. Services were held in people's homes, sure, and things like that.
Yeah.
Same as school was. Mm-hmm. The first kids were schooled in houses around Pumpkin Hollow.
So I want to get back to the Dedham connection. And were there actually people that moved west from that, or was it deer?
That was the premise when they asked for more land,
right?
Because, gee, you're taking land away from us, you know, giving it to these praying Indians. We'd like some more. And the general court said, sure.
Because
what do they care, really? If you can find the land, that's fine. And they come out, they find the land in what is now old Deerfield, that nice, flat, fertile land, and they divide it all up, and then nobody from Dedham moves. It's like, oh, but I could sell this. My house in Dedham's quite nice. Why would I want to go out onto the frontier, which is where our school gets its name, right? Because it's the frontier, with all those people who might kill us or burn our house down. We could stay here. And there's all those people who want to buy or rent the land. Mm-hmm. So they really don't, not initially. I can't say that nobody from Dedham ever moved out.
But Conway is broken off from Deerfield.
I see
that. There actually were several people from Medfield on the first settlers. And Medfield was originally part of Dedham. It broke off and became Medfield before Deerfield was settled. So there was a direct connection. But I'm not sure that... But those people who are among the actual proprietors,
that
are not positive.
Yeah, I think the 79 families that end up with shares of the property in Deerfield when it's first laid out, I don't think any of those families move here.
There's a little bit of a twist, though, because the Hinsdales that settled Deerfield. Originally, the elder Hinsdale was one of the founding members of the Dedham Church, then moved and became a founding member of the Mendham Church, then moved to Hadley, and I suspect he's the guy that informed Fisher in Dedham that there was Indian land to be had in Deerfield.
Okay. I'm just trying to put that away so I don't lose that.
So what was the relationship of the town to General Seymour Conway, Henry Seymour Conway? Was there a relationship, or what was the decision about naming the town Conway?
That's a great question. I wish I had an answer. The only answer that comes to me is it was named in his honor rather than there being a connection. I think Whately was a similar circumstance, was named in the honor of somebody who I think in Whately's case had not been to North America. I think he was...
So was the town affected by the Stamp Act at all, by Deerfield or Conway or any of these towns?
That would be later, I think.
That was Conway's doing.
Yeah, it would be affected. In what ways, I'm not sure. It's not something I've researched.
What was the book that John Pynchon wrote that got him in so much trouble?
Meritorious Price of Our Redemption.
Yes.
The reason it was banned and burned on the Boston Common is heretical.
It sounds very Calvinistic.
It's definitely Calvinistic. And the fundamental question was, did Christ die on the cross for those that were preordained to be saved, or for everybody?
Good question.
Yes, and who knows what the answer is.
Yeah. I can tell you, Pynchon was on the wrong end of the divines in Boston.
And if you happen to find a copy of the book, there are only four of them out there, and they're worth a fortune. So if you find a fifth, it's printed in London.
One more thought. Like, I was aware of John Eliot. I read a book about him in Natick. It was from a friend from Natick who lived in Conway.
Nice.
I'm just curious. I don't know a ton about him, but I think it's really interesting, that whole concept of what was going on in that relationship with the natives, and why wasn't there more of a movement like that, or were there other John Eliots throughout the colony?
And
wouldn't have that have been a better idea?
The 1,000 was split between Mass Bay Colony and a couple other places.
I see.
For missionary work.
Mm-hmm.
I think there was missionaries in New York. So it wasn't it wasn't entirely in Mass Bay Colony.
Yeah.
It was in other places.
What's there in the...
Connecticut had praying towns.
Yeah.
The praying towns up in what would eventually become Maine.
Yeah.
Martha's Vineyard,
Nantucket.
Yeah. There were about 20 different praying towns.
Okay. Don't know too much about missionary work or how,
And I look upon it as, this is a way to get the Indians on our side.
Yeah.
Right? We got the churches and Christianity, and they're looking for allies.
Looking for other Englishmen, too. While the focus may have been on Christianity, the bigger focus was on civilizing them. And civilizing means turn them into nice little Englishmen.
Right.
And that's why they put them in the town, because they could control them.
Right.
And so you divide them up politically based on the biblical order of things by tens.
Mm-hmm.
And you, so there's an elder and he has 10 under him, and there are 10 under him. Mm-hmm. And there was a fundamental belief among a number of the Puritans the ministry particularly, that no Indian was ever going to be saved. That they saw Eliot as a futile venture of Christianity, but a potential way of creating civilized individuals.
Right. Yeah, red Puritans.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. Yeah. That's exactly what they were.
And it makes perfect sense for them to do that.
Is there any sort of an estimate of how many natives, I guess you call them, were living around here at the time the Englishmen decided to occupy the place and build their fences and bring in their cows and all this stuff?
I would defer to Peter.
It's a complex answer because in 1633, there's a massive smallpox epidemic in the valley. And there are records of fortified Indian villages up valley, only 50 people survived out of 1,000. But we can't quite place it. Springfield settled in 1635. I suspect that about that point, you don't have more than about 200 survivors. And it became, the sale of land became less critical because there were far fewer people that the land base had to support. Mm-hmm. But the potential for having an English ally across the river, and remember the other factor is that these folks have, the Indians here in the valley, have been at war with the Mohawk for two or three centuries. And so one of the things that ultimately happens is that the community in Northampton, Mohawk, actually moves into the palisaded surround of Northampton in 1663 because all hell's broken loose and the Iroquois are coming over. They attack the Sakoki in December of 1663 in Northfield or Hinsdale. They attacked Deerfield in February 1665, and these guys are panicked for their lives. And they stay there within the bounds until they get visited by a bunch of Abnakis from Maine in 1670, who cause such a row and kill off a bunch of pigs that the town fathers got pissed and said, get out of here, you gotta go outside the town boundaries. So they were really, there was a, it, if you look at strictly land and you know the resources that you can hold in your hand, I think that's a, you can do that, but I think really what the Indians were trying to do is balance allies as well. The English were looking for allies and the Indians were looking for allies.
Right.
And the support base, when you look at commodities, you can look at commodities the way we think of a brass kettle and whatever, but it, within the Indian side of the equation, it's what do you do with that commodity? Well, you got a brass kettle, you don't cook in it. You coal pound it and make arrowheads out of it. Because the trade links with the people in New York where you got your chert to make your stone arrowheads had broken down. The assumption that metal goods were, you know, these sought after and valued commodities, you know, once they saw a steel axe, well, that was it. You know, they just wanted this. Mm-hmm. If you look at Pynchon's trading ledgers, 20 times the value of cloth goes out of the trading post in Springfield, than all metal items combined. These guys, the Indians are moving up and down the valley wearing waistcoats, jackets, pantaloons, stockings, caps, and a lot of yard goods in terms of cloth, blankets, of multiple varieties of English cloth.
Which was expensive, too.
Oh, it was expensive.
Hi, Jeremy. Welcome home. I'm wondering if you could introduce Peter.
Oh, I'd love to. For people who don't know, this is a friend of mine, Peter Thomas, who's archaeologist, graduate of Frontier.
Yep.
back in
class of 62.
And has come to my class on a number of occasions to talk about Deerfield history, especially around Bloody Brook, Turner's massacre, and so on. He's been doing work recently in Deerfield.
Well, one of the things that I've been doing too is photographing church records and town records. So I talked to Phil earlier, I may be up and work on yours as well, but I photographed Deerfield Church or Whateley's church records, Deerfield's church records, Sutherland's. So we're trying to gather these things digitally so that we can actually put them on the web and make them available to, for research. So I actually found the proprietor's records for Deerfield after they disappeared for the third time, so I've got those photographed.
Good.
So, anyway, yeah. The other thing too, just this is really nitpicking, but you're talking about the old village of Deerfield. And so just, it's important, I think, because I live in South Deerfield, to keep in mind that everything south of the bars was uninhabited at the same time that Conway and Whateley were pretty much uninhabited. Mm-hmm. Right. And it gets really spotty. Yes. And so one of the things I've been trying to focus on is the southern part of Deerfield more recently.
So where is the bars? I remember hearing about it.
The bars is, it's Mill Village. If you go, you know where the dump is?
Yes.
Barway Farm?
If you
it's
a
Mill Barway Farm.
In the marsh.
It's downriver from Stillwater. It's a raised terrace in there with a farm stand and some old houses and some huge old cottonwood trees. Sycamore along the road, where the old parade ground. That's the bars.
Right.
And then as you go up the hill, that becomes Long Hill.
Where's Sugarloaf Brook?
Sugarloaf Brook is right at the southern end of Sugarloaf. If you go, if you're on the southern end of the mountain, you'll find two roads come off of the road to Sunderland into a point. And about halfway between the road to Sunderland and the point, there's a brook that crosses. And that's Sugarloaf Brook.
Any other questions?
Were there Indians in Dedham when the English came, and did they make those Indians move?
I'm not sure they made them move.
Oh.
There were very few people left right around Boston.
So the smallpox had really
gone through. Did the English bring the smallpox? Yep.
There were a whole lot of people fishing here. Okay. Before the Pilgrims ever got born. The Basque are here from northern Spain, the Portuguese, all kinds of people here fishing.
Oh, okay.
And they would dry fish, and the only way to dry fish would be on land.
Mm-hmm.
So the thought is, and there's a good book by Mark Kurlansky called Cod, which sort of deals with that, and fishing in the 1500s.
I lived in Labrador, so they dry fish there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hard to do it in a boat. So, you know, if you're bringing dried fish back from America, you must be stopping in America and drying it. And the smallpox probably migrated with fishermen.
Just as a broader thing, there's a really nice little piece in Roger Williams when he's talking about earthquakes. But he was talking to informants, and they said, yes, there had been four within the past roughly century, and each time was followed by an epidemic. Mm-hmm. So we can see from the mid-1500s, European epidemics are sweeping the northern coast. And when Oldham comes in just before the Pilgrims and sets up his little Marymount and whatever, he talks about going to an Indian village, and it says it looked like a newfound Golgotha. Mm. There were not enough people left alive to bury the dead. And that's the scene in which the Pilgrims and the Massachusetts Bay Colony is founded. And so there may have been very few survivors. Quabbin was one of them, but the tribes in Massachusetts were really decimated by those epidemics.
And we really have no idea how many people lived here before European contact.
You probably got a couple hundred thousand.
Yeah.
But not afterwards, or not.
Yeah. Yeah. 50 out of 1,000.
Thanks again, Jeremy. So
If you really want to support his work, you can buy his book. But honestly, if you really, really want to support his work, and forgive me for saying this, go to town meeting and please vote the school budget.